الحمد لله رب العالمين الصلاة والسلام على رسوله الأمين.
Oh, you're going to record this? Okay, then I have to stay.
Thank you very much. First of all, my special thank you to my dear brother Farooq Chandimala. And like he recognized that in my daughter's wedding or son's wedding, I didn't move a finger, which may be true, but I think definitely my wife needs a lot of credit for this work, which is going on for 33 years. A lot of time we do not recognize our sisters who are doing a lot of work in the background. So I'm sure Sister Maimuna does the same thing for him.
No, my two sons, I work all the time.
Anyway, so we are going to talk about Muslims of India and IMRC. And the mission statement of IMRC is to help India's Muslims and minorities achieve security, freedom, and equality, their rights as citizens of India. I'll take a moment why this mission statement is kind of broad, but I want you to look at, focus on three words: freedom, security, equality. These are the three areas which is guaranteed in the Constitution of India, yet the Muslims are for 60 years suffering in these areas. There are thousands of riots have taken place. More than a million people have died, killed in these riots, but hardly anybody went to jail for these crimes. As for freedom is concerned, yes, India is a democratic country, has a lot of freedoms, but these freedoms have a boundary for the Muslims which is not there for the others. And the last one is equality. If you look at the historical background, when India became independent, the Muslims were more than 20% in the government jobs. Even right after independence, economically much better. According to the government study, Sachar Commission report, I don't know how many of you have seen or not, but Sachar Commission report 10 years ago did a huge study and documented that in these 60 years, while other Hindu minorities, even untouchable, have moved forward educationally, economically, socially, entrepreneurship, jobs, the Muslims have gone backward. They have not advanced. So that is why these are the areas IMRC and other organizations in India is working. What is our objectives? It's very clearly defined. First is provide economic and education assistance to orphan and destitute children. That's our first project which we started because of the Jamshedpur riots. We received a letter. IMRC did not plan with a big project what we are going to do and how we are going to expand. Basically, the philosophy is where there is a need, try to fulfill that need. Whether it is small or it is large. Sometimes it can be done individually. Sometimes it requires the help of a whole group. So with that, we started working children, orphaning destitute children. And even today, there are thousands and thousands of children, Muslim children, who live on the street and adopted by the non-Muslims because we do not have sufficient capability to support them. Provide immediate relief to the victims of the communal violence. Riots, which has taken the life of about 1 million people since last 60 years, there is a going on, it goes on and on. Riot in India is a misnomer in my opinion, because it is not really a riot. Riot is something which erupts suddenly. That's what we think. But in India, the riot is planned and executed. For example, it is very well documented in Gujarat in 2002 when this riot took place. Thousands of people were killed. Ahead of time, their homes were marked. These are the Muslim homes. These are the Muslim businesses. And they were burned. They were killed. While the next door, the Hindus or the others, they were spared. They were not killed. So this is not riot, but this is a constant of violence against the Muslims. And third is dissemination of information. While the Muslims are suffering in India, there is very little coverage. For example, when that black man in St. Louis was shot, CNN and every news gave 24-hour coverage. Everybody knows that this black man was shot by the police. Do you know at the same time, same week, four Muslim youth from the age of 18 to 22 were shot and killed by the police in Telangana near Hyderabad? How many of you heard or know about it? Even the Indian newspaper doesn't cover it. So it is a challenge for even the Muslims who are living to know these things. And I am also trying to give you that information via the email and the weekly email we send. So these are our objectives. As for the numbers, India is a home to 1.3 billion people, second largest population, and the world largest democracy. Yes, India is the world largest democracy. India has constitution which is better than US constitution. India gives the right to food. Indian constitution gives the right to education. But is it implemented fairly, equally? That's what is lacking. And we have to fight for it. One of the largest economy, one of the fastest growing economy, while in the United States we did a GDP of 2 to 3% in last 4 or 5 years, in India you see 7 to 10% growth. Like they say, India is shining. Is it shining really? It's shining for those who are wealthy and well-to-do, but how about those people who are not well-to-do, whether they are Hindu, Muslim, Sikh, Christian, whoever they are, who are at the bottom of the poverty line? India has grown tremendously economically, very powerful, but it is also one of the largest population living in the poverty line in the world. About total population is about close to 600 million people. And then out of approximately 180 million Muslims in India, and out of that 126 million live below poverty line. Many of you will be wondering, these are the numbers, there is a discrepancy in the numbers. These are the numbers from the government statistic. But there is another statistic which is issued by the Pew Research Center. Maybe some of you have seen the article recently in April, they issued the article giving the projections. And in India, they are projecting India population to be 300 million. And since I have friends from all different parts of the world, to give you an idea, the Muslim population of India right now, according to the Pew Research Center, is 217 million, 217. And that population is more than all the Arab countries combined together except Egypt. Yet, a lot of people think that India is a Hindu country. According to the Pew Research, in 2050, 35 years from now approximately, the projection in India's Muslim population is 310 million. That will be surpassing the population of Indonesia. India will be the home of the largest Muslim population in the world. So we are not talking about a very small number, but we are talking about a huge problem here. India has many programs. There's two kinds of programs here. What we call is ongoing program, which continuously we do it from the inception. And then what we call is a legacy program, especially for those who wants to leave a legacy behind and do something, a satkarya for a long, long time to go. So it has a feeding program, It has an emergency relief program, whether it's a riot or earthquake. Or India has amazing appetite for all these things. For example, just in last week, you saw the floods, and yesterday you saw the earthquake near India, is in Nepal, where almost 2,500 people died. And India, for example, there is a flood in eastern part of India, in Assam, Bihar, West Bengal, practically every year. Within 3 months, you will see the drought. You have, you just got the appeal for a floods, and now you're sending me the appeal for the drought?
Yes.
In Madhya Pradesh, in Rajasthan, there is a drought. So all these challenges, and the people who suffer are the most are the Muslims. I'm sorry, I forgot to turn off my phone. I'm so sorry.
Always things go wrong when you... I'm trying to, it's not switching off. I got it. Thank you. I'm sorry.
Oh, I lost continuity of the thoughts also. I'm so sorry. So we have feeding program which goes on, emergency relief, provide health care and orphan support. Feeding program which really we started very humbly with a few thousand people. Last year, in Ramzan alone, we provided 1.6 million meals. I don't know, what is the population of Birmingham, Alabama?
1 million.
Just imagine, in 1 month, we fed more people than the whole state of Alabama. Alhamdulillah.
Not Alabama, yes,
Oh, Birmingham, all right, Birmingham. Provided, distributed fitra. Again, every year we request you to send the fitra before the Eid, and also Qurbani for 4,262 Qurbanis, helping 500,000 people. In India, it still is the most economical place to send the Qurbani. I request those who do the Qurbani here and someplace else for the share of the poor. I do myself, I do here, but the share of the poor, I send it. It's only $50 a share to give a Qurbani in India. I think all of us can do it. Then we have emergency relief. This Muzaffarnagar was a riot. Gujarat was a riot. Bhagalpur was all this. Kashmir was floods. Bagarimaji was a riot. Assam was floods and riots. These are the examples of what happened. IMRC is on site usually within 24 to 48 hours, no matter where it is in India. We have over 100 partner organizations, implementation partners, who help us to implement these projects. And we provide food, clothing, medicine, hygiene kits, and temporary shelter to begin with. And in long term, we also work for the legal work and rehabilitation. In India, in a democratic society, just like here, we have to fight for our rights. And sometimes it takes a long, long time. In Gujarat, we have to fight for over 10 years. Finally, we got the judgment in a large and class action lawsuit where we received from the government compensation of 130 crores for the people who had lost their homes and the businesses. But if we do not do consistently and provide them the legal fee, which was out close to $500,000, which was paid by IMRC, we would not have gotten that 130 crores, which is equal to about $15 million. Healthcare programs, we are providing dialysis, cataract surgeries, and patient screening. In just in February, every year we go, medical doctors from the United States go and volunteer free. They pay their own travel expenses and provide the free medical care to thousands and thousands of villages in the poor part of India. And that we just did it, about 10,000 people were treated. Orphan support, our goal is to provide support. You saw the video there is a lot of girls who, and the boys, but mostly girls, because unfortunately in India, the boy brings some bread to the table, they work, even if they are 7-8 years old, the girls are the one who suffers the most, and they are the one who is abandoned. And again, orphan program is going on from the day when, alhamdulillah, we have built orphanage. And this is legacy projects, now I'm going to talk. Legacy projects, like I said, these are the projects for Sadhkajariya. We encourage you to participate in it. Like Indo-US Hospital, and this is the building of Indo-US Hospital on the left. And the Project READ. What is Project READ? I'll go a little bit detail later. Rural Education and Employment Development Program. And also when I'm going, can we distribute some evaluation form and the pens, please? Can we volunteer? We forgot to put the pens, I think. So you can give your comments and suggestions and also your input. Indo-US school in slum areas. This is a new phenomenon. In India, just in the big cities, for example, in Hyderabad and Madras, in Bangalore, in Delhi, there's a 13% increase in population in the Muslim area, Muslim population. 13%. The reason being, they are having difficulty in villages economically and security issues. So they are migrating to the big cities. And when they come to the cities, they go to the slum area. How many of you have seen Slumdog Millionaire? Have you seen it?
Yes.
Okay, that gives an idea what the slums look like. And in these slums, more than 90% people who are living in the slums are the Muslims. And we are trying to provide them schools and colleges and so on. And we are building water wells and Challenger International and Jahangirabad Institute of Technology, trying to build a university. Indo-US Hospital inaugurated in 2012, it has quality health care for affordable price. Means those who can afford, they can pay. Those who cannot, we'll treat them freely. That's what we have been doing. And you will be surprised to know that in India, a little goes a long way. For example, a cataract surgery with less lens implantation. I had to do one in my eye, I had it done. It cost me in one eye from the Kaiser. Bill was $12,000 with the lens implant. Of course, I didn't have to pay because I had insurance, I had to pay only part of it. In India, the same surgery cost what? Can anybody guess? About $200. With lens implant, we are doing it. So, when you help, it goes a long way. And then also, we provide the dialysis centers and dialysis to a lot of people and eye care. In 2,000 people, we have treated 8,000 people in this hospital, this small hospital. Then we have Project READ. Project READ is Rural Education and Employment Development Program. Why Project READ? You know everybody, do you remember tsunami which came and swept all over? How many of you remember tsunami? Most of you, right?
I was there in the city, Chennai.
Okay. So, what happened after tsunami? Millions and millions of dollars aid went to India for the relief work. Quote unquote relief work. But 80% was with the churches. With the people who went there to do the relief work, they were from the churches. They stayed there for 2-3 years. Every village has a church now which was not there before. And a lot of people became Christian for two reasons. One is extreme poverty. Number two is lack of knowledge. They do not know anything about their own religion, Islam, especially the Muslims. So in that area, from Masjidpatnam to Orissa, in the coastal Andhra, where this had a lot of impact, tsunami, close to 6,000 Muslims became murtad for the first time in the history of India. 6,000 Muslims left Islam. And when this happened, is, oh my God, what's happening? What can we do about it? So, I went there personally, made a commitment that I will go to every village where this conversion is taking place and visited there. My goal was to find how much knowledge they have, what their condition is, economic condition. Economic condition is such that they do not have, really do not have anything to eat for the dinner, for the morning. They do not have anything. Most of them do not have proper shelter. If it is raining, it's inside in their huts. Most of them do not have more than one or two pair of clothes. This is the economic. Education wise, I have to travel for almost 1 week, 19 villages, before I could find one 80-year-old man who could recite Surah Fatiha. In these 19 villages, there were hundreds and thousands of Muslims. Nobody knows La ilaha illallah, nobody knows Surah Fatiha. When they are buried, it is buried without burial prayer. They put a stick. When somebody comes, they can perform the burial prayer. This was the condition. And this is why they were becoming mortal. So we decided, we did the survey of 1,000 villages. We selected 67 villages where these people were becoming mortal. So we decided to have a maktab and a masjid. In India, it is very difficult to build a masjid in the village. They don't allow you. You have to go through panchayat, like a city council, which is called panchayat. You have to get the permission. Even though you have the land, they say, why you want to build a masjid? It was never there. You can live like you have been living. So we have through the hoops, go through the hoops. But nonetheless, what we say is also a school, which is true. So we have, then when we say school and prayer area, it's okay. So alhamdulillah, our goal was to build one masjid a year, and we did build one masjid a month, not a year. And alhamdulillah, we built, as of now, close to 80 masajid in 6 years in the schools. And each of them have an imam and a teacher who not only teaches the children, but also the adults. I visited last year also, every one of these villages which nobody knew how to recite. Now, alhamdulillah, every child knows how to read Quran.
Takbir!
Allahu Akbar!
It is because people like you who took the interest, and it takes only about $20,000 to build a whole masjid. Can you imagine that? We cannot renovate a kitchen here for them. You can provide the whole village a place where they can be proud of. And also in this masjid, villages are very poor people. Once a month, we feed the whole village for the dawah. 80 to 90% are non-Muslims. When we say we have a free food for everybody, everybody comes. After we feed them, there is a talk for an hour to introduce them to Islam, to neutralize them, so there is no hostility against the Muslims. Believe me, it is working. Water well. How many of you have carried a full bucket of water? 1, 2, 3. Lately, 4, 5. Is it heavy when it is full? Can you carry now for a mile? These women carry the water every day for sometimes 2, 3, even 5 months. Without water, they cannot eat, they cannot do anything. It's a serious problem. So we started building the water well, and it cost only about $1,500 to $2,000 to build the water well. It's a sadhajariya for anybody who wants to build and provide the water for these villages. We not only build the water just over there, usually it is near the masjid, so the water is available for masjid, and also we make a small portion of it in a small container for the animals and the birds, whoever wants the water. So, and anybody from the village can have the water. What we are planning to do in the next 5 years, build at least 4 colleges of education. Why college of education? Teacher is the most important person in the society. Unfortunately, for the last 20, 30 years, that focus has changed. Now everybody wants to be a doctor and an engineer or a computer scientist or whatever, which is good economically. But I question sometimes. It went to a point that we discourage our children, our daughters and our sons to become the teachers, where they have the most impact in the society, whether it is in America or in India or Pakistan or anywhere they are. Teachers. Before independence, Muslims used to have 25% teachers in the school in India, all over India. 25% teachers. When you are teaching in the class, as a Muslim teacher, you have 80% non-Muslims you are also teaching. And that non-Muslims get the message of Islam through your teaching and through your personality, your behavior and your actions. That is gone. Today the sad part is, especially I don't know other place in Hyderabad, agar koi bacha teacher hai to usko beti nahi denge. If a boy is a teacher, most probably the parents will say, oh no, he doesn't make enough money, he will not give you your daughter. That's how bad it is. But I'll tell you the story of one of the professor from IIT who was visiting us. He shared this with me. When he was teacher, he was going to school in the village. In village, usually there's only one teacher in up to 4th, 5th grade. Most of the children are Hindu. His teacher's name was Rahmatullah. And one day this boy, who's a Hindu, who came very late, so he asked, why are you late? The teacher said, why are you late? You're always on time. He said, because my sister is almost dying and my mother is crying and everybody is very upset, but I still came to school. The teacher said to him to take care of the class, he made him the monitor and said, can you wait? I will go and visit. He visited the home of this Hindu lady, family, and he saw that his sister has the smallpox, blisters in her eyes, tongue, ear, the whole body is full of blisters. She has not eaten for a week and she's almost dying. So, again, it's a Hindu girl, Hindu family. Rahmatullah says Surah Fatiha and gives water to this dying girl. He comes back. He repeats this at the time of Maghrib again. He prays Maghrib and does the same thing again. The girl lives. She did not die. She's a professor here in the United States. And this IIT professor, he says, it is because of Rahmatullah I was interested in science, otherwise I was not going. He is one of the top scientists who wrote 300 papers in plasma physics, IIT Delhi. The teacher's impact. Now what he does is, he's retired. All he does is points to go to the Muslim schools in villages. If there is no science teachers, he provides the funding for provide the science teacher in that school. Today in India we have only 2% Muslim teachers, while our population is close to 15%. I don't have the numbers in the United States. I don't think it's much better either. So the teacher's role is very, very important, and we have to build the College of Education not only for our own good, to do the dawah work, to have the impact in the larger society. So, again, we are planning to build 4 colleges of education within 5 years. Each college of education costs only $1 million. I know many of us in Atlanta saw and other places in California, 2 or 3 of us live in a $1 million home. If you spend $1 million, you will be educating teachers forever and accommodate 200 people in that college. So there's something to think about. Build 100 schools in slum areas. Slum areas where there is population of 50,000 to 100,000. There's no schools, good quality schools. These are Muslim children. We want to teach them. It costs only $40,000 to build a school. And we will dedicate that school in your names. And it will be a sadaqa jariya for you forever. It will teach at least 300 students, 300 to 1,000 students. Look at the cost-benefit analysis. A lot of people talk about in business ROI. There's no better ROI than this. Return on your investment, for those who do not know ROI. Continue orphan projects. IMRC volunteer program. For those, your children and the youth who wants to learn, visit, find out their roots, where they come from, and they spend their time and really learn the condition of the Muslims. They should go and spend 2 to 3 weeks in India. We have a program. One is in July, and the second one is in December. Orphan support is only $50 a month for food and clothing and education. Summer volunteers program, the dates are July 25th to August 8th. Believe me, when these children come back from India, they will be very thankful to you, and they have a lifetime experience which they never forget. The skill development programs, these are all been living for a long time. Education is the only way out of the poverty. Build 100 schools. One thing in common, no matter where you came from, if you are here and advancing like me, because you had the education. Right? And we can do that. In a matter of fact, we were talking to some people the other day, they were asking, Jahangir Awadh Institute of Technology, we formed. You can give a scholarship to a Palestinian refugee or an Afghan refugee child, send it to India, make him an engineer for only $2,000 a year for food and education for the whole year. I spent $40,000-$50,000 on my child's education in the college here. There cannot be a better relief for than that, to making a young man from those camps over there, whether they're in Syria or somewhere else. This is the Challenger International School, where we took the orphans and provided them service just like equal to any other child. The girl which was on the street did not have the food. The transition they go through is just amazing. When they come to, when we bring them, first they eat like there is nothing. They go through diarrhea. We have to go through the, sometimes shave their heads because they have so many lice. Clean them up. They don't trust you, they don't talk to you, because they have been like a wild animal living in the street on their own. And go and talk to them today. Some of them will talk to you English, and many of them are Tamils. Again, in Challenger School, in India, you cannot build a school only for Muslims. Otherwise, they will not give you the permission. We have, out of 551 children enrolled now, close to half of them are non-Muslims. Advantage, these non-Muslims, most of them pay full tuition, which is subsidized to your children, number one. Number two, we are proud to send our sisters and our sons, our daughters to convent school. Everybody tries to do that in India. In convent school, what do they learn in the morning? Lord's Prayer, right? You have to provide them, read the Lord's Prayer. And then Bible is compulsory once a week or whatever. In Challenger, these Hindu children, non-Muslim children, Sikh, Christian, in the morning, what do they recite? Lord's Prayer, Surah Fatiha. All of them, they know it. What better dawa can be than this child? And parents says, don't complain about it. They know it. And top of it, we have a Sira competition in these schools every year. And amazingly, Prabhupada, I never could imagine this. We give life of Muhammad Sira to Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam, to these children from grade 5th to grade 10th so they can read. And there is a competition held. For last 3 years, the toppers are non-Muslims, not Muslims. I don't know whether it's good or bad. This is the Challenger, this is Jahangirabad Institute of Technology. This is a beautiful place. It was Raja's palace. It was, when we acquired it, there was monkeys and snakes were living there. It was an abandoned place. We renovated it. It took 7 years for us to renovate it. Now we have a certified college of engineering, science, media, leadership training. 460 students are enrolled. If you have anybody who wants to go or send somebody, give the scholarship, this is the place you can give the scholarship. I already talked about it. This is came in Pew Research Center, April 2015. The population of the Muslims of India is 310 million. First, when I read this news, my thought was, is it a good news or bad news? Alhamdulillah, we are growing in numbers. Unless we prepare to face this challenge to improve and compete in education, socially, economically, we'll remain the lowest class in the society in India, replacing the scheduled class of untouchable. And we don't want that. And the only way out is education. I don't know any other way out. I already talked to you about College of Education. If you want to build, you can build the floors or you can do whatever you want. The scholarship fund. This also, Alhamdulillah, we have about, I think, close to $2 million in this fund. If you donate $25,000 one time, forever you will be educating two boys or girls in education. We invest that $25,000. The income will be about 2,000 and two children will be given a scholarship forever for engineering. And if you donate 12,000, it will generate $1,000 and two will support the College of Education or art student for a year, forever. So that you'll be making two teachers every year. And it's not that much if you think about it, $12,000, Satyajarya forever for those who wants to do it. And I'm sure in this gathering or follow-up, I like to see a group or individual, personally or together, build a school for 40,000. We will name it after you. You can build a masjid in Dreed you can build or give a scholarship program under your name, your father's name, your mother's name, whoever you love, as a sadhkajarya. As long as orphan and destitute will be getting the education, they will be making dua for you. Otherwise, as I already spoken to you, we are expanding media institute and we are building girls hostel. At this facility we have 250 boys, but we don't have a place for girls. We already started building a girls hostel, so they can go to engineering, media, business and so on. It takes only $200,000 to build accommodation, 50 people, 50 girls, with attached bathroom, with library facilities, with kitchen facilities. If you don't have or cannot come with 200,000, you can do at least $3,000 for one girl, shelter forever, in short. With that, thank you very much for your attention. Please accept my appreciation, taking the time off on Sunday, your day or time to rest and enjoy. May Allah bless and reward everyone you for participating. Jazakallah khair.
Assalamu alaikum. Turn on the lights, please, and we will distribute the evaluation forms, and there are other stuff on the table. Before I give it to Brother Osama, I went to this Jahangirwala Institute of Technology in 2005. The only thing I remember is that I became a Pulfi brother, Manzoor Ghori. There was no air conditioning, there was no heat. It was very, very cold, I went in winter, but I enjoyed visiting it. And they've changed it a lot. So just think about all these projects. And then Project Reed, where you build a mosque. I don't like to boast about it, but I put in some money for my father and mother. And when I got a picture, I almost cried. Because I saw those people praying in the mosque that you built. So don't let this opportunity pass. And I know these projects are expensive, but if several people got together and shared the cost, you know, it'll be a sadhkajarya. And we're also going to pass around, and I think there might be some, show the form. There's some evaluation forms. They are really not meant for this today, but I had an old form sitting in my house that had the names of Birmingham Interface Human Rights Committee and MSA for previous program, but you can still use it. This program was not done by the Human Rights Committee directly, but there were several people from the committee involved. So Brother Osama, after he finishes, we'll give him maybe about 25-30 minutes. I expect you to help out, please. Don't let this opportunity pass. We spent a lot of blood and tears getting Manzoor Ghori to come here. Thank you.
Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullah. Before I actually start in the fundraising, I want to maybe give a 5-minute talk. I think the vast majority of us, if not all, we understand the benefit of the sadaqah and that, you know, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will compensate you for it and all that stuff. But a lot of times that when we are in a fundraising event, we want to know why should we pay for this cause? Why is this important? And sometimes the more value you have for the cause, the more you will donate. So let me start by talking about the history of the subcontinent. That's how far we need to go to understand the importance of this. The subcontinent, which means Bangladesh, India, and Pakistan, used to be one country, and was occupied by Britain. But before that, long time back, the Muslims went to India, and they conquered India. There was no Muslims whatsoever. So you talk about we have 180 million, or 217 million, according to the more recent statistics, okay, of Muslims. So starting from zero, the Muslims went there, and they gave the da'wah. So those people who were not Muslims accepted Islam. Now if you count the Muslims in Bangladesh, India,
and Pakistan and gather them together as the population of one country, then they almost will form 50% of the population. So then they will become a minority. So under the British rule, they carved out this Muslim land actually. So India or the subcontinent was a Muslim land, and it was ruled by the Mughal Shahs. If you go to any Indian town, you will see the palaces. I had the opportunity to go to Bangalore and to Mysore. You see the Tipu Shah palace, all of these things that were made by the Muslims, the Taj Mahal and all that. Who were these? These were the Mughal kings who were Muslims. So India was ruled. India was a Muslim country, was ruled by Islam. Why it was ruled by the by that's why you see the certain towns called Hyderabad, for example. Why is it called Hyderabad? Because Hyder is an Arabic name, Muslim name. So why all of those names came up? Because the Muslims ruled India. So when Britain came and they carved it up, they made sure to have a massive migration of the Muslims, to go to Pakistan and Bangladesh. When they split it up, actually, I remember when Bangladesh used to be called East Pakistan, right? And then they had the war and whatever, and they had the independence. So the idea here is you split the Muslims and you weaken them by making them smaller and smaller and smaller. And make the Muslims who used to be the rulers and the kings, they become the minority who lives in the slums and have no power. طيب. India, the current India, is one of the biggest allies to Israel. The vast majority of the Israeli atomic bomb and research and whatever is done with India. If you go to India and you encounter Hindus, they ask me, are you from Israel? That's like, you are so up there, you're in Israel. So now I'm Palestinian. Oh, okay, go. India, brothers and sisters, has the potential of being the biggest enemy, the thorn in the side of the Muslim Ummah. And India has the potential of being the biggest support for the Muslim Ummah. That's why when I'm saying what's at stake here, when we do this program, they're talking about in 2050, the population of the Muslims should be 300 some. I think this could either go up or down if we only talk about the normal population increase. If you look at the nature of the Indian people, those who accepted Islam a long time back, they're still the same nature. Only the difference is that the people who introduced Islam a long time back are not the same people who are introducing Islam nowadays. The energy, the zeal, the sincerity of the people who went to India a long time ago to introduce Islam is not the same energy, and this is not the same zeal, not the same sincerity that we have now. So what needs to change? The same people accepted Islam, they're not accepting anymore. Actually, there is a large ratio of Hindus that converted to Islam. People don't know about it. Okay. So the only thing that we need to do nowadays is to understand the importance of supporting the indigenous Muslims as they are there. We don't want the Muslims to leave India. The same situation in Palestine. They encourage the Palestinians to leave Palestine. Go, we'll easy give you visa. Go wherever you want. Okay? Especially the people of Jerusalem, the people who of Al-Quds. They will give them visa very easy. Go, migrate. Where you want to go? Any country will give you the visa. Why? Because they want to vacate Bayt al-Maqdis from the indigenous people, from the Arabs, from the Muslims. And then it becomes completely a Jewish state, a Jewish capital. The same thing will happen in India if the Muslims don't support these types of projects. So what we need to do, we need to really have that wake-up call. We need to keep the Muslims there, we need to strengthen them, we need to make Islam attractive to the non-Muslims. So this 310 people by 250 will be 650 or become 800 million Muslims in India. Then India will become the backbone, the support of the Muslim Ummah, rather than it becomes the thorn in the side of the Muslim Ummah. Whatever we will do today, brothers and sisters, will help in that direction. Some of the projects here support orphans. man came to Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam complaining to him about the hardness of his heart. Ya Rasulullah, I have a very hard, tough like stone heart. I don't have mercy in my heart. Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam told him, do you want to change the status of your heart? Do you want to have a soft heart? Then wipe on the head of the orphan. Wipe on the head of the orphan. And feed him from your food. And love the masakin. And feed him from your food. So did that touch of mercy when you just wipe on the head of the orphan. In another narration, for each hair, you will get a degree on the Day of Judgment. That rahmah. So, brothers, without, I emphasize the importance of this. Okay? And again, whatever we give in the sake of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will give it to you multiple times. According to one narration I heard from Sheikh Kifah, and he did the fundraising for Ayah. He said that Sayyida Fatima al-Zahra, when she was pregnant, she craved pomegranates. So Ali had to fulfill that desire. You know, she's a pregnant woman. So he went and to the market and he could only afford one. So he bought one rumman. Yeah. Pomegranate is rumman. He bought one and went back, you know, to Fatima. In the way, some poor lady, you know, asked him for sadaqah. So he had nothing. He already spent the money on that woman. So he gave it to her. Went to Fatima. I could not get it for you. Within a few minutes, somebody came back in the door. He's got a bag. He said, Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he sent you this gift with the pomegranates in it. And he emptied the bag. So Ali counted. There were 9. So as the guy's leaving, he said, hey, come back. He said, well, he said, I think you have something still in the bag. So he looked in the bag, there is one more. He said, how did you know? He said, because Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, one, you give one, you get 10, not 9. So when I count 9, I knew you still have one left there. Because I gave one in the way of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala sent me 10 back. Okay? That's the yaqeen they had. That is the yaqeen that caused 180 million people to be Muslims in India. Shall we have that yaqeen? So inshallah in 2050, it will not be 310 million. It will be 620 million inshallah in India. Okay, let's start inshallah by, if anyone inshallah would like to give Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, to put in the hand of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, qalb hasan, a good loan, as we recited in the Quran, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, yudha'ifhu lakum ab'afan kathira. Man dha ladhi yukridu Allah qalban hasanan, fayudha'ifahu lahu, wa lahu ajrun kareem. $10,000 inshallah, let's start with that, we'll try that inshallah. Inshallah, I know that our